Hi, everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback-Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. Welcome to today's very special episode of the Dr. J Show. This episode and its companions are the very first programs in our new studio, which you're going to see when the show begins. After Hurricane Laura destroyed our offices in 2020, I started recording the Dr. J Show at my house in a closet that was converted into a studio. When we moved into this building in April 2022, I started recording the shows right here at this desk with this little camera clipped onto the top of my laptop. You're about to see our brand new studio for the first time, and I want to sincerely thank everyone who contributed to making this possible. Our production values have come a long way since the Dr. J Show premiered in September 2019, and so has the size of our audience. Thank you for being part of our journey. You all know that our content has been first rate since the very first show. We bring you top quality experts on every aspect of the sexual revolution. We bring you activists who work tirelessly defending life and family. Best of all, we're proud to bring you witnesses, guests whose lives reveal the empty promises of the sexual revolution and the life-giving hope of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Today's show is no exception. This episode premieres at the end of June 2023, so-called Pride Month. We challenge some of the myths that lie behind Pride Month. Are people really born gay? Is it possible for a person to be born in the wrong body? Is it harmful to you to attempt to change your sexual orientation or gender identity? The sexual revolutionaries want you to believe that the answer to all of these questions is yes, obviously, it's not even worth thinking about. And as a matter of fact, they haven't really been thinking about these questions for a long time. They've mostly been emoting and promoting and hoping that no one else will think very closely about it either. At the Ruth Institute, we take a different approach. We take a deep dive into the reasons why we believe the answers to all these questions is no. Therapy can be helpful to many people who experience unwanted same-sex attraction. Nobody's born gay. There's no gay gene. And no one is born in the wrong body. That idea is scientific nonsense and philosophic nonsense. It's closer to the truth to say that there are many paths into the LGBTQ life, and there are many paths out of it. Sadly, the consequences of building your life around untruth can be devastating. People misinterpret the significance of their feelings. They believe those feelings can never change, and that in fact their feelings define their identity. All too often, people who've had traumatic experiences in their lives can't find the help they need from counselors or therapists or even members of the clergy. For too long, society has accepted the assumptions of a powerful political lobby without question. We're here to challenge those assumptions and ask those tough questions. If this program is helpful to you, please consider supporting the Ruth Institute by following the links below. Let's watch.
There is nobody that is a transgender. Nobody ever transitions. What I have found is that they've been sexually abused, emotionally abused. Something happened to them that caused them to not like who they are. In fact, they were traumatized.
There's a lot of research that suggests an association between early childhood trauma and developing same-sex attraction or a transgender self-perception.
We don't use pronouns because they're false.
When we talk about LGBT activism, we're really talking about an alternate religion. There is a definite conversion process.
It isn't just same-sex attraction issues. It is, in many cases, an escape, a way to escape feeling the pain. Many of them, by the way, that I've worked with, talk about cutting their genitals off, not because they want to be a female, but because they don't want anybody to ever touch them again. They remove their genitalia so that they won't be sexually touched. It isn't about being transgender. So that's why I say this has never been about gender. If we dig down and we're truthful about it, none of this issue is about gender. It's about things that happen to individuals.
Hi, everyone. everyone. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. And you may notice I'm wearing this rainbow scarf. Oh my gosh, is Dr. Morse going wobbly on us? On the contrary, I'm on the warpath to reclaim the rainbow and to push back against Pride Month. As part of our special edition, we have today two very special guests who are familiar to many of you. We have Father Paul Sullins, the house sociologist of the Ruth Institute and author of numerous important studies. And we also have Mr. Walt Heyer, who is has been a frequent guest and participant in our events in the past, and who, in fact, we gave an award to a couple of years ago. So, Walt and Father Sullins, welcome to the Dr. J Show.
Thank you for having me on.
Happy to be here.
You bet.
So our purpose in this session is to ask and answer some important questions that have been taken as if they're assumptions in the culture. And part of what we're dealing with is the idea that people are born that way. People are born gay, people are born trans, people can't change, and so on. Okay, so that's a set of questions that we have a witness to give his testimony about, and a sociological expert who's examined some data on these questions. So I'd like to start with Walt. Walt, you lived as a woman for many years. Did you think that you were born in the wrong body? Did you feel that you were born trans? Can you identify with this type of question and characterization that we hear so much of today?
Yeah, I think when I was young, because I started at 4 years old, doing this. And so I think when you're young, this is kind of what, even though I wasn't indoctrinated by the LGBT, because this happened to me in the 1940s before the LGBT ever came out. What's important to understand is that what happened was that my grandmother made me a purple chiffon dress, put me in the dress, and cross-dressed me, telling me how cute I was. And this is what's happening today. So what happens when someone does that to a young boy is that you are committing emotional and psychological child abuse, because it is putting a boy in a dress makes him begin to wonder, why don't they like me as a boy? Apparently, you know, going through this process, I realized that what grandma did unintentionally was make me not even like who I was, because who I was not being affirmed or loved unless I was wearing a purple dress. So this is what happens with affirmation. And this is the sinister part of affirming people. Now, I think when you are, you know, when I was 8 or 9 years old and I was sexually abused by my uncle, then I think you begin to think, gee, I would have been better off being a girl. And maybe I should have been, or that's who I was. So you, all these questions you begin to ask yourself. And as we begin to ask those questions, there are a lot of people around that will affirm your questions and say, oh, you were definitely a girl in the womb. You came out and that's who you were and all that. I don't believe that anyone has ever been born transgender. I think what we do is manufacture them, and we manufacture these people who identify as transgender. And by the way, there is nobody that is a transgender. Nobody ever transitions. And I haven't even found anybody that has gender dysphoria. What I have found is that they've been sexually abused, emotionally abused. Something happened to them that caused them to not like who they are. In fact, they were traumatized. And trauma causes a lot of disruptions in our development when we're young, especially when it happens under 17 years of age. So one's born transgender.
Yeah. So what happened to you is at a very early age, you questioned your identity, but not in the sense that people mean that term today. It's not like there's a transgender gene or you had a girl brain. Something happened to you, and in your childish mind, you drew certain conclusions about how you were feeling and what had happened to you. Would that be closer to the truth?
Yeah, exactly. I think she set up in me to question who I was and who I should be and how I was going to be loved. And all of us want to be affirmed and all of us want to be loved. And when you withhold those two things like my grandmother did, it causes a great deal of strife within your own self about who you are and how you're going to present yourself.
Yes. And so today, when you hear people using this born that way rhetoric or this born trans rhetoric, how do you feel when you hear that, Walt?
Well, I know it's incorrect. And the people that I work with who come and write to me at my sexchangeregret.com website, they will tell you when they're detransitioning or they have regret, they realize after the fact that they weren't born that way. They were told they were, and they were made to believe they were, but there's two sides to this coin. When they come to the gender clinic, they're convinced that they were born that way. They live the life like I did, and some of the people will detransition within 3 weeks after, or 3 months, 3 years, all the way up to 40 years after. But when you have a sit-down conversation with those individuals, they will admit, gee, I didn't have gender dysphoria. I wasn't born that way. And they can identify what happened to them that caused them to not like who they are. And it's usually one of the 10 ACEs in adverse childhood experiences.
Right, the adverse childhood experiences, which we've talked about in other episodes of this program, because adverse childhood experiences, of course, have all kinds of ramifications. And the sexual revolution is both, you could say, is a perpetrator of some of those ACEs. And then also when children are damaged, they then have secondary problems, such as they go on to be perpetrators themselves, or all kinds of things can happen, can flow from adverse childhood experiences. And I'd like to bring Father Sullins into the conversation here. Father Sullins, you've done a variety of studies on various aspects of these questions. And particularly, you're best known, I think, at this point for your research on therapeutic interventions to help people deal with unwanted same-sex attraction and things like that. Before we get there, though, Walt has made a claim here about the impact of abuse and sexual identity issues. Is there sociological research on the question that correlates in any way child abuse, adverse childhood experiences, and what is sometimes called sexual minority status? What do we know about that sociologically?
There's a lot of research that suggests an association between early childhood trauma and developing same-sex attraction or a transgender self-perception. There haven't been studies that look at that question specifically, epidemiologically, because there is a censorship regime in most scholarly settings that would make such a study really difficult to publish. I've been thinking about it, and it's been suggested to me to do, and I might do that. But one of the reasons it's not real important to do that study is because the suggestive research is so strong. Almost every study that has collected a sample of same-sex attracted persons, LGBT identified persons, or transgender persons has found, if it asks the question, that there's a lot of early childhood trauma. And you mentioned the ACEs. Yes. Those have been measured a lot in the study that I did on sexual orientation change efforts a couple of years ago that's gotten a lot of attention. They measured the ACEs, and ACEs were much higher in the so-called sexual minority population than in the general population. Now, you're not allowed to say, well, maybe that causes, adult disorders or adult, psychological traumas, like you would do in almost every other setting. But in fact, it's pretty clear that there's something going on there.
Well, I remember when you and I had an hour-long conversation about one of those
yes.
papers where we completely nerded out.
That's right.
It was a lot of fun. But that correlation, you needed to use that piece of evidence as a control variable. Okay.
Right.
So if people have had these ACE experiences, then and they either improve from therapy or don't improve from therapy, you want to hold constant
right.
in some way
right.
for the amount of trauma that they may have experienced. And so when you just eyeball the data, you go, wow, these kids who had same-sex attraction, they're in rough shape, some of these kids. Mm-hmm. Right. And so what people people are avoiding, the scientific community is avoiding a certain conclusion. Yes. Are you willing to state for us what that conclusion is that they're avoiding?
Well, the conclusion would be that there is a definite association between early childhood trauma and the development of a minority sexual identity. That is a non-heterosexual self-perception.
Right.
That's very clear from the correlational and associational evidence in the data.
Right, right. And that's the point. And they don't, what they don't want to say is that it causes it, that the trauma caused the minority status. That's what they're avoiding.
In fact, they want to say the other way around, that you're born with a tendency or a manifestation of same-sex attraction or transgender tendencies, and that brings on the trauma. And so one of the studies that really needs to be done is a study that can really drill down and separate out what could have happened before something else in order to prove that. I want to just comment, what's really interesting to me about Walt's story, and he and I have discussed this, is that he's not reporting so much classical trauma or ACEs or an unloving childhood so much as gender nonconformity, being dressed in the clothes of the opposite sex. And I thought of, the wisdom of God's word. There's a verse in the Bible, you may know, in Deuteronomy 22, it says, a woman must not wear men's clothing, nor a man wear women's clothing, for the Lord your God detests anyone who does this. Now that's a little bit prescriptive language here, but it says that long ago, God's people knew that led to trouble. The distinction of our sexual identity as male and female, man and woman, through our dress and through our activities and through the particular proclivities that we have, those are there for our good. They're meant to socialize us into recognizing who we are as man and woman. And that's really the trouble that happened to Walter. Now, I don't know if there's
more to it.
Let Walt talk.
Okay.
Yeah, this is a very interesting intervention. And those of you who are watching may realize that Walt and Father Sullins and I have met in person on enough occasions and had enough meals together and things like that we've had some of these more in-depth conversations, which is one of the great advantages of being part of live events and not just Zoom events. But I want to hear what Walt's reaction to what Father Sullins just said.
Yeah, two things. I'll jump in first on the research, and I can just tell you that 100% of the people that I've worked with, which over 90% of them are heterosexual people who identified as a different gender, saying they had a different gender, 100% of them suffered from one or more ACEs, one of them as many as seven ACEs. So it isn't just same-sex attraction issues. It is, in many cases, an escape, a way to escape feeling the pain. Trauma is what people try to escape, and they'll find a way to do it. And so it isn't just for homosexuals or same-sex attraction, but for heterosexual as well. Then for my own life, my mother did not want me. She made it very clear. I was born in 1940, which makes me fairly old. It was during the war that was going on. They had bombed Pearl Harbor a year later, and there was a lot of things going on, and she already had my brother. She was only 19 when she got pregnant, did not want me. When I was 2 years old, she was beating me with a fry pan, and she even told people she talked about beating me because she seemed to really like whipping me. And so then I believe part of my issue was I was trying to find acceptance maybe from my mother and trying to cross dress. Maybe she would like me better. And grandma made me the dress. I initiated the cross dressing. So even though grandma kept it a secret, I was trying to find a way to be loved because obviously I wasn't being loved. I was having the heck beat out of me. And so after wearing the purple dress, then my dad started beating me. And then so I had both mom and dad whooping the fire out of me. And then I got sexually abused by an uncle. So There's a lot of things to unravel there. So I have found in working with people that they all believe that they were born that way, I think, at some point in time, until such time as you begin to ask them what happened that caused you to not like who you are. That's my favorite saying. And tell me about your life. What relationship did you have with your father? What kind of relationship did you have with your siblings, your mother? All of these things play such a huge part of it. And once you begin to ask these questions, this whole huge thing opens up and they begin to tell you about what happened to them. But you see the clinics today who are handing out hormones like they were candy, they refuse to ask any questions. This is not something they're about to do. So my job as somebody who works with the people who've been harmed and who have regrettable outcomes is to help them identify what should have been asked them before they cut their genitals off and filled them up with hormones.
Mm-hmm. Right. And Walt, I want to just take a moment for people who aren't familiar with you. Tell people, when you say you work with people, just briefly describe your work and your qualifications for doing that work and how long you've been doing it.
Yeah, well, I went to UC Santa Cruz and studied counseling many years ago, and I worked in clinical environments in psychiatric hospitals. I worked in clinics. I worked at a church as a director of care ministry and counseling, and decided that I wanted to begin helping people who struggled with this like I did, started a website, Sex Change Regret. And in 2015, we had well over 350,000 people come to the website. We were getting sometimes 15,000 hits in a day. And so out of that, I have over 10,000 emails in my inbox from people writing me, asking me questions. So I have a huge well of people who have been harmed by this. And definitely none of them have ever been counted in any of the research as having regretted it or detransitioned. Not one of them, not me, not anybody. So they keep the numbers down by not counting them. So I get an email from somebody, they tell me that they regretted having done it, and we began to dig in. I began to ask questions, and I helped them identify what caused them to do this. And in every case, in working with them, they come to the conclusion, you're right. And I was never a woman, they will say, I never should have done this. It was the biggest mistake of my life. I didn't need surgery and I didn't need hormones. And as I said earlier, I've had them at 3 weeks after surgery to 40 years after surgery, and I work everywhere in between.
So just to go back to your personal story, what was it that convinced you that you had made a big mistake and you wanted to go back and live as a man? And I keep saying go back, but that's not quite right. But yeah. You're walking back.
I was
back.
Cross-dressing, you know. You're masquerading. You know, well, the only thing surgery and hormones does, you can feminize a man, you can masculinize a woman, but you can't change them. But what impacted me the most was I was actually identifying as Laura Jensen when I was studying psychology at UC Santa Cruz, getting straight A grades in classes with PhDs. And I was really into this and realized that after being in these classes, that this was just absolute foolish nonsense. These people have, you know, they have obsessive compulsive disorder, schizophrenia, bipolar, body dysmorphia. All of these things are part of their desire to change who they are. Many of them, by the way, that I've worked with, talk about cutting their genitals off, not because they want to be a female, but because they don't want anybody to ever touch them again. They remove their genitalia. So that they won't be sexually touched. It isn't about being transgender. So that's why I say this has never been about gender. If we dig down and we're truthful about it, none of this issue is about gender. It's about things that happen to individuals. I've had girls report to me that they will dress up masculine, take hormones, grow beards. Why? To make themselves repulsive against somebody who might molest them. So a lot of this has to do with trauma, and we need to be better in the churches and helping people guide them. I tell everybody when they write me, I'm transgender, I transitioned, and I had gender dysphoria. I was writing back, well, you never were a transgender, you never transitioned, don't have gender dysphoria. But if you want to spend some time with me, we'll figure out what really happened. And so I dismiss all of that nonsense.
Oh, well, yeah. It's like you get to a certain point in your life and I don't have time for any more nonsense.
That's
the
right.
Clock is ticking, you know.
That's Let's exactly
come to the
right.
point, people.
Yeah. Yeah.
I want to turn to Father Sullins now, because you said something, Walt, that just as a economist and statistician, you said something that made my blood boil. They never ask these questions of these people. Okay. Yeah. So I want to talk with Father Sullins a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Where do they get these samples? When we see there's been a study of people who have transitioned or people who've gone through therapy or whatever it might be, when we see that there's been a study, where do these people come from? How come Walt's people are never included? What's going on with that?
Walt's exactly right. They are systematically screened out of samples for the studies of this population.
How? How do they do that?
For example, the study that I did of sexual orientation change efforts. So these are same-sex attracted people who get therapy to help them perhaps change their sexual orientation. So the study that examined these people screened its sample by saying, are you straight or are you gay or lesbian or something else? And if they said they were straight, they weren't included in the study. Now, if someone's been to therapy to change their sexual orientation from homosexual to heterosexual, if that therapy is successful, what are they going to identify as most likely following that therapy? They're going to identify themselves as heterosexual. Same with a transgender sample. There was a related transgender sample. They asked the same thing. Do you identify as transgender? They don't include people who no longer identify as transgender, but used to. If someone said to them, no, I'm not transgender, but by the way, I used to think I was, they wouldn't be included in the study. They're systematically screened out. And that's why in one of the studies I published from this, I made a point of saying this was ineffective or non-efficacious therapy because it only included people for whom the therapy couldn't have worked to the point where they could have identified as something other than LGBT. That's not unusual. That they honestly believe that only current sexual minority people are worth studying for these issues and for these problems. So Walt's exactly right. They're invisible to those who want to study these things.
We hear this rhetoric of you're erasing me, right?
Yeah.
That when Walt says nobody's born gay, nobody's born trans, you're erasing me. I exist. I really exist. But actually the people who have been erased are Walt, people like Walt, people like our friend Laura Smeltz, people like Billy Burley, people like Chloe Cole. Right. Those are the people who are systematically erased. They have
no
existence.
Just don't even look. I had one pair of ethicists in Denmark who responded to my study. They said it should never have been published. It was unethical even to acknowledge that people might have been helped by this therapy. And I responded by sending them lots of information about groups of people who have changed and have written books about it or have published it in some way or another. They completely ignored that information. Why? Because in their minds, it's unethical even to look at the accounts of people who may have changed because in their minds, it threatens the human rights of sexual minority people. To claim that they're a special group and they've grown, they were born this way, and so they need special accommodations in the laws.
Right. It's astonishing.
It is astonishing. Yes.
Yeah, and I want to go back to one of your studies because you used a bit of terminology, and I'd like to get it on the table for people who may not be familiar with this. You and I have gone back and forth on this enough that you know we could end up talking our own lingo and not even realizing it. But the therapeutic interventions that are designed to help people deal with unwanted same-sex attraction or trauma that may have led to it, and so on.
Right.
What is that therapy generally called, and what do you think it should properly be called?
Yeah, it's generally called pejoratively by those who want to eliminate it, conversion therapy, in the belief that it takes happy LGBT persons and coerces them in some way to undergo sometimes painful and unhealthy therapeutic interventions like shock therapy or aversive conditioning in order to stop being homosexual. None of that is true. It may have been true at some point in the past. It may be true in some other country that I don't know about, but it certainly doesn't happen here in the USA. A search in Great Britain could find no instance of that kind of therapy going on. So what really is going on is voluntary talk therapy that is not focused necessarily on changing sexual orientation, but is focused in most cases on healing childhood trauma. Mm-hmm. And as we've talked about, childhood trauma is at the root of most, Walt would say all, I would say perhaps almost all, minority sexual orientation or adopting a non-heterosexual identity or a transgender identity. And so when you begin to help the trauma, a lot of times that diminishes. So if you go to the website, for instance, of Joe Nicolosi's method, the first thing it says on the website is that therapy for trauma is the goal. Change of sexual orientation may be the side effect. And that's how they approach it. In fact, they're very clear that they will not try intentionally to change anyone's sexual orientation or transgender identity. What they will do is help them heal from the trauma. And then if that person wants to deal with those issues themselves, they might help them do that, but only if that person really states that as a goal of their therapy themselves. And that's very successful.
So let me ask you this. When you have been involved in these studies that look at sexual, the correct term is sexual orientation change efforts or SOCE, right?
SOCE is a blanket term that was established by the, that was coined by the American Psychological Association to cover a variety of forms of therapy. Persons who do the kind of therapy, the trauma therapy that may lead to sexual orientation change or religious or Christian counselors who help people kind of in this journey. Today, prefer the term change-allowing therapy to make the point that it allows you to talk about change, but it doesn't force you to do that. Now, that is still trying, they're still trying to outlaw that therapy. In about 20 states in the United States, there have been laws passed that would prohibit even raising the question or the issue that sexual orientation may change, even if the client raises the point, they can be under penalty of various sorts. And so the issue of change allowing therapy is an important one to make. I actually think conversion therapy is a good term because we're really, when we talk about LGBT activism, we're really talking about an alternate religion. You really have conversion therapy when someone goes in for what's called gay affirmative therapy. And they're very clear that they will not even consider anything other than helping that person to become more LGBT, to live more in line with LGBT goals and activism and pride and so on and so forth. Many persons who have been to therapy or who have left LGBT and have been to therapy to help do that, complained that they went to the gay affirmative therapist and they were just told a lie. They figured out that finally it was just not the truth. They knew that what they were doing was wrong or was not in accord with their religious beliefs or didn't help them in their heterosexual marriage. And they were looking for some truth and some answers. Persons who have successfully left LGBT or detransitioned who said, you know, I just wanted someone to level with me and tell me that I shouldn't be doing that. And they couldn't get that from the gay affirmative therapist. So that, you know, the conversion therapy is technically not such a bad term in my mind, but in the debates that are going on, it's toxic. We really should say this is not trying to convert anyone from any. If you're talking about soci, it is not trying to convert anyone from anything. This is trying to help someone overcome horrendous, usually very horrendous, early childhood trauma, and/or to come to terms with their religious experience and their desire to live a life that's pleasing to God, as set forth in the Bible or the Quran or some other religious authority, all of which are not in favor of persons living as homosexuals.
Let's let Walt respond here, because I imagine you have some things to say here.
Yeah, I want to be real specific and clear. You know, when I say 100%, what I'm referring to is 100% of the people who contact me.
Right.
So very specifically, when I work with the individuals who contact me, that over 90% of them are heterosexual. 100% of them suffered from one of the ACEs. And so this is a critical point. And then additionally, the issue of not counting people, there's a site called r/dtrans. I don't know if you're familiar with it, on Reddit. No. r/dtrans. It has... And this is not a Christian site. It is just where people go. I happen to know the guy that set the site up. I've had lunch with him. I spent several days with him, in fact, who wants to remain anonymous. But here's the point. There is 45,000 in that group. Right. Actually, wow. It's probably closer to 50,000. Okay. None of them have been counted either. So,
wow.
You can go on there, like my wife goes on a couple, three times a week just to listen to what they're saying. And this is not a therapy group. This is just people venting about their experience and saying, this is what happened to me. This is what I believe. And there's no crosstalk. It's just people giving information. And it is probably some of the most illuminating information. If you read many of the stories and listen to what they're saying, you'd go around and put a lock on every gender clinic there is in the United States or in the world, for that matter, because the harm being done by not simply, and I mentioned this when I was speaking recently to 250 attorneys a week ago today, as a matter of fact. So I mentioned, you know, the critical point in this whole thing is the moment the individual steps into a place that has the ability to give you hormones and pass you on for surgery. And if in that context, like all the people that I've worked with, if they would just say, tell me about your childhood, and if they give any one of the ACEs as a response in that question, say, well, you don't qualify for hormones and surgery because of what happened to you. Uh-huh. And what I can say unequivocally is that I didn't say that right, but you know what I mean? That every person, if they would have had the right questions asked at the point of being with that therapist, including me, there would have been no regret, because there would have been no hormones and there would have been no surgery. That I can tell you.
Yeah.
And so let me break this down and come to the point as simply as we possibly can. There are two harms being done here. One is they are being positively harmed by these treatments that are destructive of the body. That's number one. Right. And number two, they are not receiving the treatment that they really need, which is treatment for dealing with trauma. So that's on the trans side. On the homosexual side, or the same-sex attraction side, they're also oftentimes not receiving the treatment that they really need for the underlying, whatever traumatic things may have happened to them. And they're being steered into a lifestyle that is not grounded in truth and reality either. Right. They're being told you can do what you want sexually. Nothing bad will happen to you. You have these impulses, you have these feelings. The thing for you to do is to act on those feelings, act on those impulses. Nothing bad will happen. And that turns out not to be true. And then nobody wants to pick up the pieces.
That's right.
Not only not true, it's toxic. It destroys people to tell them that. Now, the research is beginning to show that the suicide rate among same-sex attracted persons or persons who identify as LGBT, it has increased so that it's higher today than it was 10 years ago. And it's it was higher then than it was 10 years before that, and so on and so forth. So what has happened is that as LGBT identity has become more accepted and less stigmatized throughout society, and the LGBT activists have become more dominant, more prominent, actual persons who struggle with LGBT identities have gotten worse. Have gotten more stressed.
It has not improved their. It has not improved their psychological function.
It has done just the opposite. And so, what we're seeing is a culture of death, a toxic message that goes out to these people. You're okay. There's nothing wrong with you. When there is a lot wrong with you. Well, what happens if you tell someone who has a disease or a disorder? Oh, there's nothing wrong with you, and they don't get treatment for it. Well, they get worse. They die. And so that's really what's happening. It's
you know, there's an analog to that with feminism, because there's this so-called paradox of declining female happiness. And the people who find it, you know, they look at in absolute and relative terms, women are less happy today than they were 50 years ago. And the standard narrative is, gosh, that's really funny. We can't figure that out. Well, those of us who are women who always felt that feminism was against us, you know, that we were the targets in a sense, not men, but we never felt uplifted by feminism. We always thought there was something wrong with it. We're not the slightest bit puzzled by why you're finding these data of women feeling systematically, in absolute and comparative terms, less happy. It's the same sort of thing. You're chasing the wrong rainbow, if I could that phrase. All right, and every step you take down that path takes you further from truth, therefore further from the things that will really authentically make you happy. I want to come back, though, to this one point about conversion proper, the term conversion, which is a religious experience by which you convert. That means you change your heart and you go from one path, go to the other path. Walt, I'm interested to know what the impact of religious experience was for you in your decision to transition in the first place, your decision to detransition, your walk ever since then. What role did faith play through that whole journey?
Yeah, well, that, you know, I was a believer before I had the surgery, and but the impact that we know from studying these things, that adverse childhood experiences last you a lifetime until you get treatment for them. So when I was studying at UC Santa Cruz and began to realize there's underlying comorbidities that hadn't been addressed in my own life, that I just sort of, you know, the therapist who told me, oh, you need to have hormones and surgery, blew by them, because I told them to him and he said, oh, they're irrelevant. And so when I realized that was the case, then as I began to examine these things, then I started going to, as Laura, to a Christian counselor in California and spent time with him. And he gave me his time for free. And he said, you can contact me anytime, because he had never ran across anybody like me. So I was in therapy sometimes 4 days a week, sometimes 9 at night, sometimes 10 at night, sometimes 9 in the morning. And he was collecting this information and providing therapy for me literally anytime I wanted. He ran a large therapy center with about 70 therapists. During that time, I began to realize, you know, what had happened. We had the feedback, and then I was recovering from alcoholism and drug addiction. And so my experience on my fourth step was during prayer, after having therapy and realizing where I was with my relationship with Christ, during prayer, I experienced the Lord came to me and literally picked me up and restored me. And he said, you'll be safe with me forever. And he held me in his arms. That was the moment that I was redeemed and restored. So it was a journey. You know, this was, you know, I was 1990 and I was born in 40. So you can do the calculation. It took a long time for me to get there. So, I say this because I want people to be encouraged and not be discouraged, that this is a long, difficult journey unless you're able to access good, appropriate information about what caused you to take this journey and then interrupt that process with proper and effective treatment, then you won't end up having the experience that I had.
Yeah, you ended up in a good place, but it was a long route, right?
Yeah,
with a lot of unnecessary detours. Father Sullins, do you want to chime in on this question?
Well, I just want to underline that the thing that really brings healing to anyone is Jesus. Not the thing, but the person that brings it is a relationship with Jesus, a discovery of God's love and grace and mercy. You know, we are not all born LGBT or transgender. We don't develop many of these things, many of us, but we are all born with an alienation from God, with a life that's apart from Him and suffers in some way or other. And the answer to that is Christ. So what has struck me in studying this population is that people who find an active relationship with God really do get healed from this. It we can say in miraculous ways or in ordinary ways, but there really is healing available. I've also become aware that the other path is also a religious appeal. And if you read enough of how people are socialized into a gender dysphoria or a transgender identity or into an LGBT identity of some sort, there is a definite conversion process. And it's been studied by scholars looking at how these things happen. They don't even recognize it, but it's definitely there. There's the initial contact with another LGBT person. There's the act of coming out, which is a lot like telling your testimony for right. someone who's undergone a religious conversion. Mm-hmm. There's a socialization into the community. And then there are barriers to exit that community. You're going to lose your friends. They really are offering an alternate religion in the LGBT appeal. And that's one of the reasons that they're so strongly against persons who leave it, or therapy, or the witness of persons who say, well, you know, I found another more healthy, more wonderful way to live in Christ. There really is a black and white conflict between these two things.
And you know, a couple things come to my mind. One thing that comes to my mind is the extreme hostility against religion that a lot of LGBT people have. That, you know, I was brought up Catholic and it was so terrible and I left the church and they didn't understand me, but now I found Father James Martin or whatever, and so maybe I'll be a Catholic again or something.
There are actually several studies of this that find that it's harder for an LGBT identified person to come out as religious than it is for a person to come out as LGBT in a setting. So if you're in a religious setting and you declare, well, I'm gay, that's difficult and you're going to face some struggles and opposition and discrimination. But if you're in a gay setting and you declare, I'm Christian or I'm a follower of Christ, that's even more difficult. And there's more difficulty and opposition in that. So there is a real bifurcation on these issues. 30 years ago, you had counselors saying we should respect the religious convictions of LGBT people. And if they would like help to live in accord with their religious convictions, we should provide that or should refer them to people who will do that. That was the standard of care that was put forth at that time. But that has all changed. Now it's so-called therapy. Gay affirming therapy is really an indoctrination into another religion, another way of living. And very often those who go to alternate therapy, the soci therapy, are motivated by a religious experience or an experience with God. that puts them on a path toward freedom. There really are three types of persons who desist from LGBT identity or are not congruent. So if you look at persons who engage in homosexual sex or identify as LGBT, those don't always overlap. But in the latest research we're doing, we find there are three types of persons. One is persons who are just experimenters. They graze lightly in same-sex relationships. They usually only have one or two. And they may or may not identify during that time as gay or lesbian, but they generally identify as heterosexual today. So that's one class of those people who did have some same-sex experience, but then no longer do.
Okay.
And then there are a group of persons, mostly men, who identify as heterosexual, have always identified as heterosexual, and have been in heterosexual relationships, but also engage in homosexual sex, often secretly, we might say on the side, and they do that continually. And so I call these the closeted homosexuals. And then there are the true desisters, persons who had a significant same-sex relationship or experience for quite a period of time, and then have left that, and now are in a heterosexual relationship or have heterosexual sex with other people. But for the most part, they enter into one single heterosexual relationship.
And so I sometimes say the following, and I want to see what you guys think of this statement, that if you take LGBT as a whole, including the T's and the L's, there are a lot of pathways in, and there are a lot of pathways out. Mm-hmm. So that to say you're born gay and you can never change, that seems to me certainly untrue. That seems to be certainly not true. What do you think of that? What do you think of what I just said?
Well, yeah, one of the things that came to me when I was listening to you is the people who contact me. I've never heard of somebody. Nobody's ever contacted me I've worked with who had a secret homosexual life. They were all heterosexual. Many of them identify as being a lesbian, which is even crazier. But one of the things most interesting, I think this kind of typifies, one of the people who contacted me was working in a pharmacy. He was identifying as a female. And when he came out, then the CVS decided to put all the other people identifying in that one pharmacy so they'd all be sort of grouped together. And when he contacted me about his wanting to detransition, I said, "Why do you want to detransition?" He said, "I looked around when I was working there in the pharmacy at the other people identifying as transgender. I thought they were nuts. I did not want to be one of those people. I'm contacting you so that I don't have to do this, because it really horrified me when I could see the reflection of what I looked like." And so I think they come to this realization that it's pretty horrifying once they see themselves in reflection.
That's really interesting. Father Sullins, what do you think?
I think of the story of the prodigal son where it says, "And he came to himself." I think every one of us, when we're wandering in areas where we shouldn't be, and God has told us we shouldn't be, we can come to a point of self-recognition, self-discovery. Think of alcoholics, you know, who have to come to the end of their rope. I think that's common for many of us.
Yes.
And I think that those are the people that to their credit, will contact Walt, and he's able to help them.
I've never converted anybody. By the way, good point. Everybody who contacts me has already made up a decision.
That's right.
A decision, and all I do is I do detransition affirming care. How's that?
That's good. I like that.
Right.
That's great.
Do either of you have any final words here? I feel like we've covered the main points that we want to cover. Is there something that we haven't covered that you feel our audience should be aware of?
Paul, for jumping all over you there.
No, you go right ahead.
From my standpoint, I think we've given the listener a great deal of good information and we've given it to them in spoonfuls, and, you know, we don't want to give them a dump truck load where they go away kind of not knowing what they heard. So maybe a little bit is good at this point.
Okay.
And Walt, do you have anything to say to parents who are watching their kids go through this? And sometimes the parents are just horrified and can't figure out what to do. What would you recommend to the parents?
Well, first off, look at the computer that the kid has and what they're researching on their computer. And I always tell parents, if they have a computer in their bedroom, take it out of the bedroom, put it in the living room. Don't let them have a computer. Don't let them have a smartphone until they're 18 years old. Because the stuff that they're getting indoctrinated on in there is really bad. If they have a child who's starting to come out and say they're this or that, I always have the parent, when they contact me, sit down and ask them, what has caused you to want to do this? And where are you getting your information? Those are two important things for the parents to begin to dig into. And I've been able to have, I don't get involved in, I always work through the parent to have the parent working right with the child, because they're going to be living with the child for the rest of their life. I'm not. So when the parents get involved in that process, we find the kids do detransition if the parent has the sort of the willingness to dive in. Many parents are afraid to get in there. They're fearful. I've had parents take their kids out of school, period. I said, you just have to take your kid out of public school and you're going to have to homeschool them. And maybe grandma's going to have to do the homeschooling or somebody else. And so there's been cases where one or two parents together will do this and they'll join in homeschooling together. So the schools are horrible. The internet is horrible. And parents need to keep their kids' head and face and mind out of that stuff.
Father Sullins, do you have anything to recommend to parents?
Sure. So parents for a child who says, I'm gay, that is often a moment where the child really wants care and attention from the parents. It's a cry for help. And parents should respond with sensitivity and caring, sharing that burden, carrying the burden. And like Walt has said, to really get into understanding why it is that the child is feeling that way. I agree with removing all the external media influences you can, because they are just toxic. They're terrible. I recommend a book. It's called A Parent's Guide to Preventing Homosexuality by Joseph Nicolosi. And you can buy it. You can't get it on Amazon, but you can get it on Books A Million. And you can get it direct from the publisher. And it sets forth some very concrete, clear ways that parents can help their children. The basic idea is that there's an imbalance in the child's mind, not necessarily in reality, but in the child's mind, there's an imbalance between the care and affection they're getting from one parent rather than the other. And if it's the opposite sex parent that they're not getting the attention from, then they may develop some attractions to same-sex, having same-sex attraction as a result of that. You can read the book and find out more about how that happens. But many, many young people that I deal with that have same-sex attraction describe that as their experience, that often a distant father and an overly protective mother for a boy will help to encourage these things. I wouldn't say that it causes it, and I don't know that it's necessarily wrong, but parents can learn about these things and can lovingly adapt to help their child walk through this.
Let me ask one final question. What do you suggest for the body of Christ, for the church? How should people in the church address persons who are dealing with these problems in one way or another? Walt, I think you have some insight into this matter.
Well, I'm actually working with two different groups on actually developing criteria for how to do that. Now we're in the stages of doing that, but we don't use pronouns because they're false. And what we do is we begin to work with them really from a therapeutic standpoint, and begin to do just as I do with everyone, to find out what caused them to come down this path and try to identify what the underlying issue is. And what I found in working with people, once they realized that it was something else, they got addicted on the internet to porn, or it was a social contagion, or it was an ACE, they themselves don't want to be a part of this nonsense anymore. Right. And so they sort of automatically go, okay, now I get it. I didn't realize this. So churches really need to get into it. Churches are afraid to talk about it, but we're going to come up with some criteria to help every type of church. And so I work with Muslims, I work with Jews, I work with every different nationality and group there is. And many of them, you know, they don't like Jesus and they don't like faith, but even them who are struggling with issues, I can help them. And then at some, in some cases, they weren't believers, but once they get healed, they become believers.
Father Sullins, do you have any thoughts about what the body of Christ and the churches should do or should not do?
The church should address these issues in the same way it addresses other kind of traumas and disorders that people get themselves involved in. I'm thinking, for example, of Alcoholics Anonymous, which was developed out of a religious setting. Instead of declaiming persons for the sin of drunkenness, welcomed people into a community of care and love and of healing and a definite order of moral recovery in life, and found that you really don't have to speak judgmentally to people, because alcoholics will speak more judgmentally to one another than anyone who's not in that setting. They're willing to challenge one another when they get to that point. And so I think the church should approach it with great love and community and openness, but create the conditions so that truth can be said and truth can be heard.
But the truth, it's always got to be based in truth.
Always got to be based
on truth. Would agree with right. that. And many of the churches and many branches within certain churches are not doing as well as they should be in the whole area of telling the truth. So
absolutely.
All right. Well, gentlemen, thank you very much for this special edition of the Dr. J Show to resist pride and to give people some authentic hope. I really appreciate the time and expertise that both of you have put into this. And I feel sure that this episode is going to be a great blessing to a great many people. Thank you so much for being my guest today.
Thank you. It's my pleasure.
Thank you, Jennifer.